So the term couple means two, right? So couples in statics and beyond specifically represents two couples. And what Dailene said was very good. In terms of what, right? So let's take a look at the following slide. And it says here, a couple is a force system that consists of two, and this is important, parallel forces. And this is going to answer Dailene's question. Having two different lines of action, but equal in magnitude, okay, but opposite in sense. So if I were to draw a couple based on this definition, I have two forces, two parallel forces, but having opposite sense. So I have one force going up, one force going down, but they have the same magnitude. I'm going to call this F, right? They have the same magnitude. There are two parallel forces. They, of course, have different lines of action, two parallel lines of action. They're equal in magnitude, but opposite in sense. But maybe I should point out here, going back to what Dailene said, they also have the same, oops, same angle of inclination. Let's put that in there as well.
So this is something like gravity, because gravity pulled you down, but you're a force fighting against it, right?
Not quite. You're referring to the action is equal to reaction.
Yes.
Okay, so let's say that I'm going to add one more here. Notice that these two parallel, oh, why isn't my pen working? Okay, there we go. So between these two parallel forces, I'm going to measure the distance d. And notice that this is a perpendicular distance between these two forces. Okay, so for those of you taking notes here in your notebook, put your pencil right where your perpendicular distance d is located. Put it down in your notebook or on your notebook. So this pencil is representing our perpendicular distance one more time. Notice that the force F on the left-hand side is pushing your pencil upward, right? But notice that I'm not telling you to fix your pencil at any particular point. So the force on the left-hand side is pushing your pencil upward. The force on the right-hand side is pushing it downward because they have opposite senses, right? So what happens to your pencil as a result of these two forces being applied to your pencil? How does your pencil rotate?
Clockwise.
Clockwise. Okay. So couples, when we use the term couple, it's kind of inherent in that term that the forces, these two forces, are going to cause the body to rotate. Not with respect to any particular point, but couples will always result in rotation. So a couple tends to cause rotation about an axis perpendicular to its plane, and that perpendicular meaning that perpendicular to, well, I kind of drew it in the vertical plane, but if you're looking at your notebook, right, it's coming kind of straight up, right? It's going to rotate perpendicular to the plane in your notebook as you're looking it down. It's vertical, right? Okay. So again, I try not to say the moment of a couple because it's kind of redundant. Couple means rotation. Now, to make some kind of relevance to your everyday life, I said to you before, moment means just any general rotation, right? But then I typically get students asking me, is torque a moment? And I said, what did I say before? I said, yes, but I would consider torque as a subset of moment. What causes torque? Couples do. Couples are responsible for torque. But we don't use that term torque in this class because we're talking rotations or moments in just general. But torque is a special moment caused by couples. And for those of you who will be taking mechanics of materials in the future with me, we're going to be looking at torque or torsion. caused by couples. So these things will come back to you in future classes. Okay, so let's talk about some of their characteristics. Well, I have the example here. Well, I kind of did it already, but okay. So I have the same example here, right? So you go, hey, my pencil, what happened to my pencil? Kind of got erased. But anyway, we did the same thing just now. For the couples, before we get into something very difficult, and remember I said to you, there's a big challenge in statics, and that big challenge is related to couples in 3D. And this is the biggest hump that I'm referring to in your statics. Once you can go over this hump on couples, after this chapter, it's going to become a lot easier, in my opinion. So this is the most challenging part of statics. But let's first take a look at these characteristics. Once we understand these characteristics, analyzing for couples becomes much easier. And of course, there are a lot more characteristics, but I've simplified those characteristics that I think are important and that are very relevant to what we are going to be talking about in this class. So the first one says the moment of a couple is a product of one of the forces and the arm of the couple. Now, what is this arm of the couple? Going back to the picture in the previous slide, this perpendicular distance between the two forces of a couple, the technical or the statics term here is the arm. But we can just continue to call it the perpendicular distance, but when it comes to the couples, they call it the arm. Okay, so that is the arm of the couple. So the first characteristic says, if you want to find the moment of a couple, remember I say it's kind of redundant to say the moment of a couple, because couple, we know that it's going to be causing rotation. So sometimes in my class, I tell them this is kind of, you know, redundant. So I just, you know, put the moment in the parentheses. But until we get used to it, I think it's okay for us to say the moment of a couple. Okay, so the moment of a couple is a product. I did not specify whether this is an algebraic product or vector product, because depending on whether you're using vectors or scalar components, it's actually the same thing. It's a product. So if you're using scalar, then it's an algebraic product, or if you're using vectors, then it's a cross product. Okay, so I did not specify. So this can be either scalar product or algebraic product. Typically, that's what we call it, or cross product, depending on what on your analysis method. So if we're looking at a 2D, a couple in 2D, your formula here, and I would, and we're going to actually use this formula. It says here, the moment of a couple is equal to F times D. Where have we seen and used this formula before? We've used this before, right?
2D.
2D, very good. Before the Varignon's theorem, we use the straightforward perpendicular distance between the force to its moment center, right? Okay, so it's exactly the same formula, but notice that it says one of the forces and the arm of the couple. So let me go back to the picture that we have here. So if I choose, and it doesn't matter which force you choose, you can choose either the force on the left-hand side or the right-hand side. Let's say that, I don't know, I'm going to ignore this one on the right. Okay, so if I take the moment of the couple, I just take the magnitude of this one force. It doesn't matter because they have the same magnitude, right? It doesn't really matter. And the perpendicular distance, D, between the two forces. Now, if I ignore this force to the right and consider only the force on the left-hand side, and I'm going to choose, let me erase this, by eliminating the force to the right, let's say that I'm going to pretend that this is my moment center. As I put my pencil over the arm of the couple and I fix my pen on the right-hand side, and push this upward, how does it rotate? Does the direction of rotation, does it change from before? Still clockwise, right? Let's say that this time I'm going to ignore this, and I'm going to look at this force to the right. So this time I'm going to fix my pencil on the left-hand side. The force on the right is pushing it down. How does my pencil rotate? Still clockwise, right? It doesn't matter. But the way I did it with you before, I didn't even care for the moment center. I said, just put your pencil right between the two forces, push it up and push it down. It still rotates clockwise. What does that mean? It doesn't matter how you analyze for the moment, either by choosing a moment center, eliminating one of the forces, or considering both forces together, you're always going to end up with the same answer. That's the beauty behind couples, okay? But that also presents a challenge because you will not be told of the moment center from this point on. You get to decide your own moment centers. So going back to the characteristic, you can find the moment of a couple by just taking the magnitude of one force and multiplying it to the arm of the couple in 2D. In 3D, look at this formula here. It's the same formula that we just used today in analyzing moments in 3D. It's still R cross with F. Again, taking just one of the two forces in a couple and crossing it with a position, a distance between the two. Okay, and again, I'll show you all these examples. Second characteristic, oh my gosh, I'm out of time. Anyway, I just happened to look at the clock and I saw 12:15. I thought I still had more time. Sorry guys, I got too excited. But anyway, when we come back on Monday, we'll pick up with the characteristics of